Now in our own time.
Well, when I came to work for Harvard Business School in early 1963, the dean, George Baker, told me that he would like to spread the light of Harvard in the developing world. We had a school that we had helped start in India, several in Europe, one in Iran even. So I went back to Washington, where I had been working in the Kennedy administration, and I saw my friend Walt Rostow in the State Department. And I said, in effect, Harvard wants to spread the light. He said, wonderful, where would you like to go? And I said, well, I don't know, what would you suggest? And he said, well, President Kennedy has just made a major speech in Costa Rica.
I congratulate you on your efforts to reestablish an historic unity to meet new needs. And I pledge my government's continued assistance to that great effort.
And he is working with the presidents of the six countries of Central America to help them establish a common market and integrate the region. A very exciting project. They need managers, public sector, private sector. They need managers. So why don't you go there? And so I thought to myself, this is going to require a government contract. People were worried about having a government contract, academic freedom and that kind of thing. So I said, well, any chance of a letter from the president to our dean? He said, certainly, George, my secretary is sick. You go out there, you write whatever letter you like, and I'll get the president to sign it. So I'm sitting there, dear Dean Baker. Sincerely yours, John F. Kennedy. Well, I got back to my office a couple of weeks later, and the dean called me and said, hey, George, guess what? I just got a letter from the president. I said, no kidding, what did it say? He wants us to go to Central America to help train managers. So I said, how can you say no?
The original spark was when President Kennedy came to Costa Rica. Interesting times, the volcano had just blown its top, Irasu, sort of a sign of God.
Many of us were very influenced by JFK, the idea of development, the importance of dealing with poverty, that whole spirit. One of the key ideas was that change requires leaders.
The idea was to replicate a two-year case method graduate business school in Central America to build a managerial class in hopes of developing a substantive middle class.
The force of a good idea is unstoppable. It was a really good idea.
The first problem was to find a leader who could take charge of this effort. A Central American who other Central American leaders would listen to. Everywhere I went, I got the same name, Francisco de Sola of El Salvador. I was told, if he is with you, you cannot fail. If he is not with you, you cannot succeed. When I described the sort of thing we might be able to do. He said, I remember very well, it will be difficult, but we must do it. It wasn't easy. There were many times when we both thought the end had come. But he was very persistent. He was very determined. And he wouldn't give up. And so he was the founder of INCAE, without any doubt. And he suggested that spring of 1964, he would get the top leaders of Central American business to come for executive program, and I would get our best professors.
Efectivamente, yo asistí al primer IPAC en CAE cuando no era en CAE todavía. Y fue mi padre el que se enteró y me dijo que si quería ir a ese seminario, a ese curso. Y por supuesto que le dije que sí. En ese entonces, los hijos no eran tan rebeldes como son hoy día. Éramos más obedientes.
The participants couldn't get enough of it. They were up all night studying the cases. Their participation was very exciting and dramatic. Hammer and tongs, they were going at each other.
Esos programas de INCAE, aún ese primero, fue muy duro.
And they learned what it was that management training was all about.
After hours, they would start talking about the future of the institution that would come out of this experience.
And what happened was we prefabricated an alumni of business leaders in the six countries who put together the committees that established INCAE.
Lo primero que hicimos fue que INCAE formó un comité nacional y yo lo dirigí.
And that's where they got most of the key people who were the original champions. That proved to those initial 20 or so that it was a really interesting venture.
So that from the very beginning, INCAE was independent of Harvard, independent of any government. It was the creature of this group of leaders who had become committed by virtue of this experience with this type of teaching.
The case method is part of the Socratic thing. It has a couple of elements. One is there's a real case with all the complexity that you study.
I went down to write cases the year or so before the first class.
At one time, we had 40 researchers in Central America. We wrote 800 teaching cases.
George was a fireball. He had enormous energy. So he organized the first group of researchers who came to the region.
We trained the Central Americans to be the early faculty professors of INCAE.
And they were very interested in teaching and becoming good case method teachers, which is an uncommon way of teaching, particularly back in those days and certainly in Nicaragua.
What you discover for yourself, you're much more likely to remember than what you're told.
So I went down very frequently. I estimated I made something like 30 trips to Nicaragua. And we appointed a man who was named Clark Wilson as the first rector. So Clark went all over Central America getting students to sign up. So then we got Ernesto Cruz, and Ernesto proved to be a very strong and capable rector. We had no endowment, we had no fallback position, and Ernesto, he personally signed notes from the bank to meet our payrolls. He borrowed it, for INCAE, but they made him sign his own signature. You know, getting some institutes not get started, there are lots of problems and lots of things to work out. There are no traditions. Well, I think anyone who works with him, a new organization, a struggling organization, and sees it gradually up and getting going, becomes very emotionally attached.
The earthquake comes very dramatically.
I went down 2 days afterwards because the campus was damaged. People were scared. Some of the faculty wanted to go home.
Whole parts of the center of the city were cut out.
Instead of the Lido Palace where students had lived in the beginning, it went boop, 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 boop.
The school was very precarious financially. Pedro Belli and Werner Kettelholm, we had a little computer, did a macro model of how much foreign exchange we needed. If properly managed, the earthquake could be turned into a development motor for Nicaragua.
Well, Harry Strachan was another one, though, just put everything into it. He was very, very imaginative and very, very strategic kind of a thinker.
And I was sort of heading up the project, writing up a plan for reconstruction.
He wasn't going to let it fail. There were a whole lot of people there who weren't going to let it fail.
There were representatives from the U.S., World Bank, and so we presented it to them. Well, within a week, INCAE had received a grant of $1 million to provide help. Within about 2 months, we had the MBA going again. For me, an example of not just surviving a crisis, but lo que no mata engorda, what doesn't destroy you will strengthen you.
In adversity, you bond thicker than blood. We had a wonderful group of NICA, Latin Americans, and Americans all working together side by side.
How do we create a financially solvent model? We had a $5 million debt. And then the earthquake comes, and then the Sandinista was something very similar.
That was a critical and difficult time. It was a little bit dangerous. We expected them to come up and close us down. The faculty got together and said, and we will educate any people you Sandinistas send to us to train. You've never run a government before. We'll help you learn to do that. The Sandinistas were extremely anxious then for us to stay. It was a very dangerous time in the life of that institution.
Mark is another one of the heroes.
Harry and Mark got this strategy of having a second campus, which was a tremendous financial stretch to raise that money, and now it's to support two campuses and two faculties. But we kept the thing going in Nicaragua, at least at that time, in order to serve that struggling country.
There were many wonderful people who came along after him, Walter Kissling from Costa Rica.
En aquel momento, él estaba recibiendo llamadas porque era después del fallecimiento de Don Chico. Tenía su vida llena y le dio a INCAE bastante tiempo. Y yo creo que eso es una de las decisiones que él nunca se arrepintió, porque la verdad, para él INCAE era parte de su corazón.
Walter was a businessman. He never, I think, finished college. He was sort of a self-taught man and always wished he'd had more education, but in fact, he read more, learned more. Walter was that way.
Él quería estudiar y no pudo. Y luego logró ser exitoso. Le hizo ver la importancia de tener una buena educación. Y yo lo recuerdo muy bien, siempre nos decía que lo único que él nos podía dejar en esta vida era una educación.
I came to INCAE as an MBA student. Many of my friends, colleagues, and bosses had graduated from there, and I saw an opportunity.
It is easier in retrospective to see clearly the trends that were emerging in the 1990s.
It was a time of new democracies all over Latin America, a time of growth.
But one was the transition from war to peace in Central America. After decades of conflict and civil wars, they were reaching a general peace agreement.
It was a decade that was actually very good for the region.
The second change was the collapse of the Soviet Union and the end of the Cold War.
It was a time of opportunity for business, and everyone saw it like that.
Those two things together changed entirely the picture of Central America from a political agenda to an economic agenda.
When I first got to INCAE as a student, the two things that amazed me were the diversity and intelligence of my peers and the value and wisdom of the faculty.
Students come and students go. But the faculty is the absolute heart and soul of any educational institution. And if it is not superior, solid, high performance, then the output of the school, the graduates, is going to reflect that.
The other issue that came, and stronger through the years, was the issue of sustainable development. Because he had the Rio conference in 1992, which essentially defined that we were reaching the end of unlimited resources, and that development for its own sake, without a balance on the social and the environmental side, was leading to disaster.
The future of INCAE is towards sustainability and ethics.
One key element was meeting Stefan Schmidheiny.
Stefan Schmidheiny has been a huge help to the school in making the students and the faculty aware that they should think about sustainable economic development.
What we set out to do, and I think we achieved, was bringing together the ideas of sustainability, of eco-efficiency, dealing with resource scarcity, not as limits, but rather as an integral component of prosperity, competitiveness, and growth.
Roberto Octavia was the first rector of the 21st century. His vision was to connect these younger leaders with the societal goals of sustainability and development, and he led INCAE into that direction very effectively.
We were in charge of implementing the ideas of competitiveness and sustainability, transferring it to the countries, to the leaders of business and government.
So you've got this marvelous marriage between a constantly increasing faculty with progressively greater and greater expertise and ability to teach and ability to research, married within this context of sustainability. To me, it's the perfect storm. And that's what this school is about. Because out of all of that comes an increasing middle class that reduces the barbell effect on either end between concentrated wealth and concentrated poverty. And you fill in the middle.
I think a perfect storm is a very good term because it shows that you need a coalition of several factors, all coinciding at the same time to really create a quantum leap. And I would call it the perfect opportunity.
And we started a company which went into the next phase of development of the economy in Costa Rica. Because what we did was we exported coffee, but we exported it to the gourmet trade.
Globalization was, in a sense, a great way out for the challenges of development.
We exported to these oddball importers, one was called Starbucks. So we became specialists in adding value to coffee's raw material.
You can say, look, my coffee is very good. I'm going to create a brand, and I'm going to market it as a brand.
One of the first things we did, we talked to INCAE.
The case of Cafe Brit is a role model for all kind of other things that can be done, not just in coffee, but in all kind of other fields.
INCAE set the roadmap for what Cafe Brit is today. Since INCAE has been in Costa Rica, sort of corresponded with a quintupling of our GNP per capita.
If Central America is going to make full use of its resources, human and natural, it must integrate.
INCAE is an institution in Central America. INCAE has promoted the common economic integration in the region.
It must act as a region, politically, economically.
There's been a lot of other cases in which INCAE has played an important role in policy making and policy shaping. Here in Nicaragua, INCAE has been very instrumental in the dialogue between the private sector, the government, and the unions. When Ortega came to power, a lot of people said, you know, oh my God, we're going back to the 80s, confiscation, devaluation, you know, hell is gonna break loose. And it didn't. But INCAE played an important role, training a lot of people in the Ortega government, teaching them about economic development and how business is a part of it. You can't have economic development without a healthy business climate.
Without a school to train managers in a broad way, covering every sector of the economy, the region could not lift itself up.
We have about 13,000 INCAE graduates. 13,000. And those 13,000 have created hundreds and hundreds of thousands of jobs.
The story of INCAE is the story of people. For the past 50 years, people from the United States, Central and South America have built this institution.
I think this idea that a business school is more than just a management trade school, but really a force in society is what I think makes it unique. I think it has the opportunity to have an influence that's much bigger than its size.
For the next 50 years, we are attracting leaders who are coming from all over the world, from all walks of life, and who are engaged, who are motivated, and who want to build this new INCAE.
I was invited by the board, and I wanted to have a sense of the mission and the goal. Was it just another business school, or was there something about it? And I think it was, first and foremost, started by very bold people. And as you know, the gods favor the bold. And I thought, what a great initiative. The INCAE Illuminate campaign is embarking on its first ever endowment. An endowment is essential for the growth, the prosperity of a school, and for its ability to be nimble and to attract top-tier talent.
They have really come to love the institution. They are passionate about it. And I think they are going to make an enormous difference for INCAE.
Who is interested in the region? Who is interested in entrepreneurship? Who is interested in building Latin America as a whole and getting more people to know about it? Because it is a wonderful organization. We have to spread the word about it, especially in the United States.
Whenever you do a legacy, you want something to happen after you're gone. You want to be able to have left something that's made the world better. And I don't see any better way to do that than to support education.
The emerging countries, the emerging world will have a lot to teach the developed world over time. Bringing the developing world to a more prosperous level makes them better trading and intellectual partners for a better world. And having an institution of this caliber accelerates that process.
INCAE has already gone through several generations of people that have devoted fundamentally their lives to make a contribution through INCAE to the region. And I see every signal that this is continuing. And that is beautiful to see.
This is what Jack Kennedy had in mind. They knew what the problem was, and this was the way to address it. And that was a long time ago. We're talking 50 years now. This school has just come, it's come light years from where it started.
We celebrate here today a great victory, and that is a victory for the human spirit. These books are today freeing men and women from centuries of bondage and poverty, and I am proud as a citizen of the United States to be here in Costa Rica taking part in this great effort. And I want to assure you, we will stand and work shoulder to shoulder. But this journey to Costa Rica has illuminated the minds of 180 million people of what a great opportunity and privilege we have to be associated together in our common cause.
Well, I don't know this, but I wouldn't be surprised if you talk to USAID today, I wouldn't be surprised that they would regard INCAE as perhaps their most successful effort in Latin America over the last 50 years.
Thank you.